Very good afternoon to all my dear students. I am Professor Shaurya Shah and welcome to the lecture of SYBBA Semester 3, subject is Financial Management. Dear students, in the last lecture, we had studied various methods regarding your capital budgeting and investment decisions. We had completed 5 major methods and we have seen the practical sums for each and every method also. Fine. In the last lecture, where we stopped was this sum, right? I hope everyone must have again referred back the sum and the formulas for each and every method. I told you the same sum, students, which we solved according to the payback period method, right? I told you that we will be solving the same example of university by 4 different methods so that you can have idea and you can be again revising all the methods in detail how you have to calculate it. Fine. So I suppose you all must be clear with the last lecture's sum. Again today we'll be again revising the payback period, what we did in the last lecture, and then we'll be continuing with all those 3 methods and then we'll compare the results obtained by each and every method. Fine. So students, this was the example which we discussed in the last lecture. What has been given? 5 years are given. So what is the economic life of the project? 5 years, right? Again, the cash flow before taxes and before depreciation is given and the discounting rate is given. Fine. This we saw in the last lecture. What you need to do is you need to calculate according to the payback period, average rate of return, net present value and PI. Fine. So we'll see one by one. All these things we did in the last lecture, right? So the sum had again some of the informations. That is, cost of machine was given to you, installation cost was given 10,000. This we saw, we calculated the total investment. Fine. We covered this in last lecture, so we'll be going very quickly, then we have to allocate the time for the rest of the methods. Fine. So this is the cost of machine, that is total investment which we calculated, 50,000 rupees, right? Now again, for working out payback period, cash flow after tax but before depreciation is considered. So what we did, students, we calculated the 8 columnar table for the various things, right? It was as follows. First column is always your years, that are the 5 years, that is the economic life of the project. Second column shows you the cash flow before tax, right? The cash flow which is actually given in your question, in your sum. After that, we deducted the depreciation. How we deducted the depreciation? That is the 50,000 total cost, total investment divided by 5 years, because specifically it was said that it is your straight line method. Fine. So we deducted depreciation from each. What the resultant we got was your cash flow after depreciation. In the first year, as such, cash flow and depreciation are same. So the answer was 0, so on and so far, right? From that, we deducted the corporate tax rate, that is 55%, right? So 55% was my tax rate. I will calculate on this column. So of 1000, it was 550, 4000, 2200, 5000, it was 2750, and likewise, fine. So I hope everyone must be clear with this 4 columns. After that, what we got from deducting 1000 minus 550, 450, 4000 minus 2200, 1800, what is it known as, students? It is known as cash flow after tax, right? But as I told you one line, that for working out payback period, we require cash flow after tax but before depreciation, right? After tax but before depreciation. So what we usually do is we calculate the tax amount, we deduct it, and then we add back again the depreciation so that we get the cash flow before depreciation. I hope it is clear. We had discussed in very much detail in the last lecture. So on this basis, just take into account this cash flow after tax amount, that is 11,250. On that basis, we calculated the cumulative cash flow, because I told you there are 2 methods. First is your fixed cash flow, which is same for every year, and the second is your cumulative. So as such, students, when it is cumulative cash flow, that is fluctuating cash flow, you need to calculate the total cash flows of every year, right? So what we'll do is the last column which you are having, cash flow before depreciation, you will do the total of cumulative. First year it will remain the same, second year it is first year plus second year, third year it is third year plus fourth year, right? So on and so far, you have got the cumulative cash flow amount of 61,250. Now, what is your payback period, right? As you all know, payback period is in which particular year and which particular month you are getting back the investment which you had made. So if you can see in the table, students, the total receipt at the end of the fourth year is 44500. So I can say that I am getting the investment of 50,000 back between fourth year and fifth year, right? So again, fourth year and fifth year to be exact, I can say 4 years are completed. In the fifth year, I am getting 16750. So if in 12 months I am getting 16750, what is the difference amount? 5500, right? So total receipt at the end is 44550, that is 500. 50,000 minus 44500 is 5500. So if in 12 months, students, I am getting 16750, so in 1 month, that is in 5500, how much I will get? Right, so answer comes to 4 months. I'll get my 5500 back in 4 months. So what is my payback period? 4 years were completed, and in the fifth year I'll be getting in 4 months itself. So my payback period is 4 years 4 months. I hope it is clear, students. Just to brush you up with the method we already discussed in the last lecture, I again tried to revise those things. Fine. Today we'll be starting with the rest of the three methods which is asked in the sum. That is, the very first is average rate of return. We have seen each and every method in detail, students, along with their merits, demerits, formula and how to solve it. Fine. I hope it is clear. You are also simultaneously solving it. I am making an assumption. Fine. Now, starting with the average rate of return method, students, the second method is your average rate of return, right? How you calculate average rate of return? Now, for computing ARR, profit after tax or cash flow after tax is taken into account, right? For a single table, in every method, the input you are taking will be changing, right? So, in ARR, which column you are taking? You are taking profit after tax or cash flow after tax, the sixth column in the previous table. So, if you are solving the sum simultaneously, in your this table, the sixth column, that is your cash flow after tax, this column you need to consider, right? So, I have already made the total in advance. What is my total of the cash flow after tax? It is 11,250. Note this down, students. This is 11,250. So, what I'll do is, for computing this, I'll take the sixth column. What is the total for 5 years? 11,250. Just now I showed you, right? So what is my average profit for 5 years? If it is 11,250, for 1 year it will be how much? So 11,250 divided by 5, so I'll get an average profit of 5 years, that is double to 50, right? I suppose each and everyone is clear till here. What is the method average rate of return? We had discussed in advance only, right? In the previous to previous lectures about ARR, that what is the formula? Average profit upon average investment. So for that you require these two things, right? So we have found out 2250, right? What is average investment? Average investment shows you the value which you can find out with various formulas, but in this sum we will adopt the same formula which we took, right? What is average investment? It is original investment plus scrap value divided by 2, right? I have directly found out here. You can write if you want. The formula is original investment plus scrap value divided by 2. So here, students, original investment is 50,000. We calculated, plus scrap value is not given, so take it 0. So 50,000 plus 0 divided by 2 gives you the answer of 25,000, right? So I have got my two things. One is average profit, second is your average investment. Now what you need to do is you need to divide this thing. So average profit is 2250 divided by average investment 25,000 into 100. So you'll get the rate of return, that is 9%, right? So the answer according to your ARR is 9%. I hope it is clear. You don't need to evaluate the results, just you need to find out the values for each and every method in this sum, right? So I suppose it is clear to each and everyone, but for that, your table is the most important thing. Your entire sum is based upon this table only, which will be helpful for every other method. I hope it is clear. Fine. In exam, students, hardly two or three methods, most probably two methods are asked that you need to solve. Any of the methods can be asked in your exam. Fine. I hope everyone clear now with payback period method and average rate of return method. Moving ahead is your net present value, the NPV method, right? NPV method, again we saw What is NPV? It is net present value. For computing NPV, profit after tax or cash flow after tax, but before depreciation is taken into account, right? Again, column number 8 in the previous table. So what is the column number 8? Column number 8 shows you the cash flow after tax, but before depreciation, right? Cash flow after tax, but before depreciation. So we'll take those columns. What you need to do is you need to add down the years. You need to write down the cash flow. Then you need to discount that. This is the last column which we saw just now, students, right? Individual sums also, we have practiced it very much. So your factors which are given already in the question, you need to multiply those factors. 10,000 into 0.909 gives you 9090. 10450 into 0.826 gives you 8631.70, right? Go up to two decimal, students. 11,800 into 0.71 gives you 8861.80. Then 12250 into 0.683 gives you 7366.75. 16750 into 0.621 gives you 10401.75, right? So you can calculate simultaneously. What you need to do is simply remember under which method which column is to be taken and what is to be considered. Whether in a method it is your cash flow after tax, whether it is cash flow after tax before depreciation, whether it is cash flow after tax after depreciation. So that with your method you need to remember. So what we'll do is here, years you have written, cash flow you have written. This cash flow is the last column after tax before depreciation. You have calculated the discounting factor and you have got the present value, right? Do the total as usual. The total which comes, you need to deduct it from your investment, the original investment which you have made, right? So here your value comes to 44352. And what was my original investment? 50,000. So what is net present value? It is negative 5648, right? So what does it indicate, students? We always remember that accept the project if your NPV is higher than the original investment. No businessman or no sound businessman can invest in the business where he is getting negative NPV, right? This indicates that today if I invest 50,000, after 5 years I will be getting the return of only 44352. So it is a loss, right? So whatever the NPV comes, take the decision of accepting or rejecting the project accordingly. I hope it is clear, right? NPV. If you are clear with NPV, your profitability index is also done. Fine. What was your PI, students? PI, if you remember the formula, it is exactly the same, right? For computing NPV, profit after tax or cash flow after tax, but before depreciation is taken into account, because PI is similar to NPV only. My all calculation will remain the same, right? I hope it is clear. Now, what you need to do is just simply, instead of deducting, divide it. So present value of cash flow divided by present value of investment, right? So what is my present value of cash flow? 44352, we found out in the table, divided by original present value investment. So 50,000. So 0.88 I am getting it. I hope it is clear to each and every student. Fine. No doubts in that part. Fine. So PI also we calculated. If you are able to solve NPV, then your PI will come automatically, just a step ahead, right? I hope it is clear. So what we have done is, students, we have solved the same sum with another four methods which we have studied till now, right? I hope it is clear to each and every student. Payback period, average rate of return, NPV and PI. Fine. So today we'll be again moving on to the again last part of the chapter, that is the last method, internal rate of return method, the IRR, right? IRR is the most technical method amongst the all whatever we have studied. Either they may be discounted cash flow techniques, either they may not be discounting, non-discounting cash flow techniques, right? So we'll be seeing what is the method all about, fine? For every method, students, remember this chapter is having the maximum weightage in the syllabus, that is 30%, right? So for every method, theoretically, you need to remember the steps of the method, where it is used, what are the merits, demerits, and there will be a practical sum also out of this chapter, fine? So we'll be starting with the internal rate of return method, students, right? What is the method all about, first of all? This method is based on the present value of the future net cash flow, right? This method is based on the present value of future net cash flow. What does it mean? In every method, students, we have calculated the cash flow. Either it was given in the sum or we have estimated. Then what we do is we discount those cash flows with the various cost of capital discounting factors. On the basis of that, we decide whether to accept the project or not. I hope it is clear. Fine. So next is your IRR is the rate. Now what is internal rate of return method actually about? That you need to understand. What is IRR? IRR is internal rate of return, right? Is the rate which equates the present value of future cash flow with the investment, right? Whatever investment I am making right now. So I am making 50,000 rupees investments, for example. Just now we saw in the last sum, right? What does it do? This is the rate. Now actually in your ARR, that is average rate of return, we calculated 9% if you remember, right? So that 9% we calculated, but in this method we need to estimate okay, what will be the rate which will equate the present value of future cash flow with the investment. The answer of the present values which we calculated should be equal to the investment which we are making right now, right? So in simple terms, if I explain what is IRR, IRR is that rate which makes the cash flows of the future which I am going to get over a period of 5 years equal to the investment which I am making on the very first day in my project, right? So I suppose it is clear. IRR, it will be much more clear when we study the formulas and all. What is, again, in another words, if I say IRR is the rate which makes the NPV of the future net cash flow equal to zero, right? NPV of the future net cash flow equals to zero. What do you mean by equals to zero? Just now we calculated the net present value, students, right? If I explain you with the help of this, what is IRR? Here we took the various factors at the rate of 10%. So I got a negative value of 5648. If I increase this factor by around 10.5% or 9.5%, I can get the exact amount of 50,000 rupees here or nearby, right? So what is the rate? The rate at which this value is equals to this value so that we can get the zero amount here, right? That is known as IRR, that is internal rate of return method. I hope it is clear. Fine. IRR is known as IRR because it is based on investment, cash flow and reinvestment of that cash flow in the business itself, right? Because it is also known as your internal rate of return, means the rate of return which you are getting on the investment which you have made and the cash flows are, again, it is assumed that reinvested in the business and then you are getting it, right? You must be aware with the term of your cumulative fixed deposit. In the bank, generally there are two interests, simple interest and cumulative interest. So whenever you are making cumulative FD, your interest is again reinvested in the principal amount and then you are getting much more interest on that. That is known as compounded interest, right? In simple terms. So similar concept is assumed here. I hope you all must be clear with the concept of IRR. Fine. Now how this method is calculated, right? So following steps you need to again understand. In every method we have seen the steps. First of all, the economic life of the project is determined. Right. So dear students, you need to first determine the economic life, how many years the project is going to work and how many years cash flow are going to achieve. Right. It may be 2 years, it may be 3 years, it may be 5 years, it may be 10 years. So first of all, decide the economic life of the project. The second thing is capital expenditure of each project is estimated. What will be the total capital expenditure of each project? You need to estimate, right? Maybe 50,000, maybe 1 lakh. In the last sum we saw that was 50,000. So similarly you need to calculate. So first, economic life. Second is your capital expenditure. Third, prediction of the net cash flows is done and then it is discounted by a rate of discount which makes total investment equals to cash flow. So whatever we did in the NPV method, right? So you need to estimate the cash flow, you need to take the rate and then you need to find out the present value and compare it with the actual investment. I hope it is clear to each and every student. Fine. So prediction of net cash flow is done, that we have predicted, and then it is discounted by a rate of discount, right? Such a discount rate is known as IRR. So here in every sum we have seen discount factor at 10%, discount factor at 5%, discount factor at 15%. So what is this? This is known as IRR, that is internal rate of return. I hope it is clear to every student. Fine. So for finding out IRR, trial and error method is used. Now this is most important. In every method we were been directly given the cash factor, that is your capital factor, cost of capital, 10%, 15%. Here you need to find out those rate at which both become zero, right? So how this method works, students, on the basis of this formula. But before that, you need to decide the economic life, you need to estimate the capital expenditure, you need to predict the cash flow and discount those cash flows. Clear in the steps? Now this formula is used for calculating the IRR, right? So again, understand it with the help of a story, right? It is like a story, only stepwise will be going. What you have done, you have done the four things, what we have decided. Now on the basis of this, you need to calculate. This is formula is nothing but simply the table which we are preparing, right? It is just given in a formula form. What is C? C is the investment. So if I compare it with the last sum, what was my investment? Investment was 50,000 rupees, right? A1, A2, A3 and AN. That is AN means the last installment or the last cash flow which you are getting. So what does it having? A1, A2, A3 are the net cash flows during the economic life of the project. So if my life is of 5 years, then it will go for A1 till A5. If it is for 10 years, A1 to A10. Is it clear to all of you? Fine. In the denominator, it is 1 plus R. What do you mean by 1 plus R is internal rate of discount, right? That is whatever factors which you are having. At 10%, suppose you are having 0.909. At 10%, second year you are having 0.826. So that factors you need to take it in the denominator. It is, students, keep in mind 1 plus R, 1 plus R square, 1 plus r cube and 1 plus r raised to n, right? That is raised to 1 plus r, 1 plus r square, 1 plus r cube. I hope it is clear. So with the help of this formula, this is nothing but the table which we are making. In the columnar form, we write down A1, A2, A3 in columnar form. Then we write down the discounting factor. We multiply those factor and then we add it, right? So simply in the formula base, it is given. Now how this method actually works, students, this is the formula. Now you have to use trial and error method. Just now we saw in the points of your method, fine. So what, how you can do is you can understand with the help of a story. Beginning is made with a certain rate, right? So we will begin the method by taking a random rate, maybe 10%, maybe 8%, maybe 7%. What I need to do is I need to be ready with my investment first. I need to be ready with my cash flow first, right? So I will begin with certain rate. Now future cash flows which we are having will be discounted, will be multiplied with this rate. The total of this is found out, right? The total is calculated. Once we calculate the total, again, if the amount exceeds the investment, right, if the amount exceeds the investment, your discounting rate is very much high. So they are not equal. So again, try again, right? You need to again and again try it. Now try it with the higher rate of discount. If it is 10%, now try it with 11% or 12%. Again, repeat the same, multiply it with the cash flow, calculate the total of the cash flows, that is discounted cash flows. And if the value again exceeds the investment and if it is not equal, again try for the third time. Again, take the higher discount. So you need to take the higher discount, right? The rate of discount ultimately at last, which equates the discounted value, that makes the column total of discounted cash flow and the investment equal. That is your internal rate of return, right? So again, if the discounted value is less than the investment, in the second trial a lower rate of discount will be selected. So it should not be less than also, it should not be more than also, it should be equal to your actual investment which you have made. I hope it is clear to each and every student. Fine. So this is your IRR method. Again, very rarely asked in your sums, but if asked, you need to solve it. We'll be solving the examples of IRR also, but if you are clear with that part, we can move forward at present to your merits and demerits of the method. Fine. I hope everyone is clear with that part. Fine. Starting with the fine. So starting with the merits of the method, what is the merits, dear students? The very first is, it is more reliable as it is based on the time value of the money, right? So because it is based on the time value of the money, we have seen various methods in which time value of the money is involved, right? Because we are discounting the cash flows, so that itself says time value of money. I hope you all must be clear now with the concept of time value of money. The second is, it takes into account the net cash flows of all the years of economic life of the project, right? In the previous method, that is payback period method, we saw that only up to the year in which we are getting back our money, our investment, we consider that thing, right? But dear students, here entire life of the project is considered and all the cash flows are considered. So that is an advantage. Selection decision is made on the basis of profitability, right? Definitely, those projects having the higher profitability, higher rate of return is selected so that you can earn maximum out of the profit, not on the basis of the number of years or not on the basis of the, again, we can say cash flow, it is selected on the basis of profitability. It is also consistent with wealth maximization objective. Fine, every method should be consistent with wealth maximization objective. As such, profitability is included, then wealth maximization is also achieved. It limits the capital expenditure equal to the present value of internal cash flow. Fine, it limits the capital expenditure equal to the present value of internal cash flows. Fine. So capital expenditure, whatever we are calculating the rate of discount, should be equal to the present value of internal cash flow. If it is more, we'll calculate once again. If it is less, then again we are going to calculate it. I hope it is clear to each and every student. Fine. So clear with five merits. The very first, it is based on the time value of money. Second, all the net cash flows of all the years of economic life are considered. Third, selection is made on the basis of profitability. Fourth, wealth maximization is achieved. Fifth, it limits the capital expenditure equal to the present value of internal cash flows. I hope it is clear. Moving on, every method has the demerits. This method also has demerit. The very first thing, it is very difficult to understand and calculate IRR, right? As such, I begin the method with the term of technical method, right? Amongst all those methods, if you see, you also can feel that this method is a bit tricky, or we can say complex calculations are involved in that, right? Again, it is a time-consuming process. So you need to calculate, right? Next is, assumption that net cash flow of each year is reinvested in business at same IRR may not be true in all cases, because we are assuming that cash flow of each year is reinvested. Business same cannot be the, again we can say same. Fine. So students, the next is, so dear students, if you see, the assumption that net cash flow of each year is reinvested in the business at same IRR may not be true in all cases, right? So what does it mean? We are assuming that in the beginning of the method only I told you that there is an assumption that all the rate of return remains the same of the cash flow also, of investment also, and of the return which we are getting is again reinvested in the business. Fine. So it may not be true that in all the cases the IRR may remain the same, because IRR itself is a trial and error method, right? So for every business we need to calculate the exact point decimal IRR for getting equal amount of the investment and of the various kinds of cash flows total which we are getting. Fine. Again, moving on to the next is, time value of investment is not considered, students, right? We are calculating the time value of the cash flows, right? But the investment remains the same. Even after 5 years, I am calculating my initial investment of 50,000 rupees only, right? So the investment which I have made, again, that also should be discounted so that I come to know exactly whether my discounted cash flows are equal to my discounted investment or not, right? I am calculating my simple investment originally with my discounted cash flows. So that is also a limitation, students. The next is, your investment itself is interpreted differently, right? So in various terms, your investment is interpreted differently. The original investment is taken, sometimes the original investment minus scrap value is taken. So all those may change, fine. Again, in the time value, students, time value of investment is not considered. There is one more point. There is a possibility that investment may not have been made at the time and may be spread over the some years, right? Investment, if I see, I am calculating for the entire economic life. So again, it may be possible that over a period of years, this investment may not be spread. Originally, I can get it back within 1 year or 2 years. So there, this method fails. And the last is, if there is a difference in economic life, size of investment and timings of cash flow, this method cannot give the results consistent with NPV, right? So if there is any difference, we are assuming that everything remains the same and are in consistency with each other. But any changes in economic life or investment or of cash flow happens, then this method cannot give the reliable results, fine? So this is the major limitations of the IRR method, students. You can go through it once again. I'll give you 10 seconds to see the points. If any doubts, you can see. Fine, so I hope each and every one of you must be clear with the demerits and the merits of your methods. Fine, so students, we have completed the chapter of your first chapter, that is long-term investments of your financial management syllabus, that is of my part, right? In your unit, it is your second chapter. So all the methods in detail, we have completed them with merits, demerits, with practical examples of each sums, fine. So next lecture, I'll be starting with the few of the university sums involving your methods. So I urge you to again revise all the methods along with the formulas, along with their working, how you have calculated, make a notes of it, fine. So I'll provide you again with this methods in the next lecture. I suppose each and everyone is clear with that part. If any queries, any doubts, you can post it in Google Classroom. We are here to help your queries, fine. So I suppose that is enough from my part today. We'll conclude the lecture here, students. Thank you for your attention. Have a nice day ahead. This is Professor Shaurya Shah teaching you financial management, SYBBA, semester 3. Take good care of yourself. Thank you.